my 7-year-old Shelby asked me when we were in a courtyard setting with several people around that could hear me if I answered. So I took Shelby off to a corner and I whispered, "Shelby, I'm years old." Shelby said, "Grandma, I just want you to live to your 90s so you can tell me more of your childhood stories." Oh, my heart sunk. She's a wonderful child. I got a bee in my bonnet about 3 or 4 years ago. Time goes so fast that I wanted to learn how to be a good storyteller. And tonight, I'm going to tell you how I began that journey. I'm going to tell you my first story, and I'm going to tell you a surprise that I got at the end of this first story. And it is my hope that you will be so excited about this story that you will want to become a storyteller, I'm sure, better than me. Since Simple is my best friend, I was looking for someone who could give me a simple idea on how to start storytelling, because why should it be so hard? So I looked and I found the Orinda storytelling event, which does not exist anymore. But I went to their second to the last meeting. They had an entire weekend, but I'm too busy to spend a whole weekend listening to that. So I had 4 hours I could give. And I went on a Friday afternoon, and I tell you, I was so lucky, because it was blind luck and I got it. There was a master storyteller there who was also a good teacher on how to begin storytelling. And besides that, he was a Choctaw Indian. The first thing he said was, "Quick, think of the first two smells you have from childhood." And then he said, "Now, make up a story about one of those scents." My two scents were eucalyptus trees and gardenias. And I thought to myself, now that is going to be one of the most boring stories I have ever heard. But what he did was so helpful. He had us break out into groups, and so I got to practice on what he really was telling me. And this is what happened to me. When I was a little girl, every morning at 8:30, I would go out of my front door and I would walk along the crunchy gravel out to the front. I would pass the carriage house made of brick that my grandfather built on the left side, and on the right side, I would also pass the big garden that we had for our vegetables and fruits. Past that, I would walk under this big fuchsia tree, and I always thought that flowers were upside down in the first place, and then I would smell the roses, and I would finally get out to the sidewalk, and then I would turn left, go to the end, and then I would turn right, and there I was on El Camino Real. And they had eucalyptus trees for miles on both sides. And I know somebody planted these on purpose, because these trees were exactly so many feet apart as you walked down, and they were across exactly on that street. On the left side, it was a path, a dirt path and bushes. But I was walking on the right side of the street where there were houses and apartments and a bridge that I'd look over every day to see if there was going to be water from the creek, but it was usually mud. And then I finally made it to the school. 1 mile each way, I got my exercise. These trees had a calming effect on me. This was all before the age of aromatherapy. A eucalyptus does that to you. So look what I got when I was a child. Calmness. But there's one thing I must tell you about my hometown of Burlingame. When I was there as a child, it was a small town. We talked over the fence to our neighbors every day. We had 4 blocks of stores. We had 1 library, 1 gas station, and a grocery store and a supermarket. So it was very small. And I knew most everybody in town, and if I didn't know them, I would know about them, because there was one lady in town that just loved to be a busybody. She was so nice, I really liked her. And one thing I probably shouldn't tell you, with the neighbors, I loved climbing up to their roof on hot days, eating ice and reading comic books. But one day as a teenager, I was gone from home and I came back, and I need to have my hair cut. So I crossed the street to Mr. and Mrs. Jewell's house. They had this big picture window at their house so people could look in and see that they were busy, because they had the beauty salon. And I went in there, and you know what Mrs. Jewell's told me? She said, "For 6 years, I used to watch you come out of your driveway, walk down to the end of the street, cross over right, and I would see the chaperones next door who'd give you a shout out and wave. They were watching you just like I was. And then you got to Mrs. Hines' house, and she watched you too. But what I didn't know was that my Aunt Irene was watching. She worked as a secretary for one of the biggest churches in town. I mean, this church had stained glass windows, it had Gothic doors. I mean, you looked at it and you feel like you'd been churched." She looked out her window when I came by, and she made sure that she saw me till I was almost at school. What a wonderful time I had. And I look back on that now and I realize I was a very fortunate little girl to have all these people care about me. They would watch out for me and keep me safe. And this is how I began my storytelling days, by just thinking of a scent and going and making a story out of it. And I used it for the history to tell my grandchildren, and they just want more. So I hope that you will be able to use the scent that you think of to tell your story.